with a long string of pearls, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, indeed, you're gonna have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Thank you for joining us today on Something to Think About with Pastor Mike, where the topics can range from current events, historical perspectives, practical Bible application, to whatever's on his mind today. People have stereotypes of what it means to be a Christian, and one thing's for sure, Pastor Mike loves breaking those stereotypes. Pastor Mike Hasseltine is the senior pastor of Maranatha Church with campuses in Forest Lake and Chisago, Minnesota. With over 40 years of practical pastoral ministry, Pastor Mike challenges us to be real people, loving a real God, right in the midst of all our real lives. Now, here's Pastor Mike.
Hey, good morning, everybody. It's nice to be back in the studio again every Friday. Look forward to this time. We can just ramble on, and sometimes we talk about serious stuff as the intro goes with Pastor Robin. Sometimes not serious stuff and all that. Hey, thanks to a couple of our producers over there, Mike and Jay. How you guys doing?
We are good.
You're good. And Jay's giving me the old thumbs up because he doesn't have a microphone handy. Yeah. Hey, you know, we happen to have the station manager around, too. So I'm going to... I just heard some interesting news.
What's that?
Really interesting news.
I mean, okay, like,
I had no idea. So
I'm
like,
living in
I'm waving
you
in to the radio room here. And I'm like, hey, you got to step in here. I got to ask you a question.
Go for it.
Pickleball.
Oh, I love pickleball. I love it. Really, you know, Jesus, husband, family.
Hey, wait a minute. This is radio. People
church,
cannot see you wincing.
Church, pickleball.
At husband.
You know, maybe Jesus, pickleball.
Should have been no here at hesitation.
No, family.
Jesus,
you know.
Husband, with enthusiasm and confidence.
Yes.
But no, you were like, yeah, you know.
It depends on the day. No.
Oh,
I love
man.
My husband. I'm married to an amazing
okay,
man.
Okay, so I realize that real often you get together with some women on Fridays and you go play pickleball.
Yes.
So Pastor Robin just told me, though, that you mentioned there's the five love languages of pickleball. What in the world? Five love languages of pickleball? Is our world truly going insane?
I think so.
I really think so, too. So what are they? Tell
okay,
us.
Here we go. So someone sent this to me yesterday, and we call ourselves the Friday Picklers in our group. So quality time. Be my partner for this next game. Acts of service, driving me to and from the courts. Physical touch, bumping paddles after a good point.
Oh, man.
Words of affirmation, this is my favorite, telling me how awesome a partner I am. And then gift giving, buying me a new paddle.
Buying you a new paddle.
Of course, this is a takeoff. What was it, Gary Chapman that did the five love languages? Great stuff. Really good tools to have in your toolbox to know the people in your world, your love language. So I'm just turning the spin around. Do you know what Orlean's love language is, your wife?
Yep.
What is it?
I'm not going to tell you.
Oh, for Pete's sake. I will tell you what mine is. Acts of service. When you do things that for me when I haven't had to ask or they're unexpected or...
Really?
Yeah. Yes.
You know, I think men in general, again, broad brushstroke, it's just being respected is the biggest thing that they long for or really appreciate. It's just being respected. Now, I realize that some husbands aren't respectable like yours. You had to hesitate a little bit there.
Oh, goodness.
You know.
Here we go.
Oh,
yeah.
God, if you're listening right
throw him right under the bus.
Honey,
but no, I'll throw you under the bus.
Yes. No.
Because you were hesitating. You had this mysterious, winching, wrinkled-up look on your face.
Don't you dare, like, make it something it wasn't.
Oh, it was.
I think that was Jenny's contemplative face.
It was.
Thank she you, was Pastor
Robin. Oh, really thinking about
yeah,
it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, no, I have just become such
husband,
an... Yeah.
Was coming out rather slowly.
It was the dramatization of, like, how much I have grown to love pickleball. Because it's like, in the last year, it's like, it's awakened something in me that hasn't been in there since I played competitive sports.
I was just going to say, you've
20s,
been an
yeah.
athletic, you know, yeah. lady your whole life, so. But,
and it's just fun, the fellowship. We laugh a whole lot. I will just say panty liners are required.
Oh, that's good. That is good. Either that is a measurement of your age or the fun you're having. I'm not sure.
Let's just go with fun.
Yes, exactly.
It could be a measurement of each one.
Yes, yeah.
Oh, God. Come play pickleball. Make sure you're wearing a disposable diaper.
Yeah.
Wow. That escalated quickly.
Sign me up for that, right?
Yeah. What we have found, it's been a great touch point of, you know, people beginning to invite others in and brought them into church and having a great time and just, you know, being in a safe place to learn, too, because some of those groups are a little competitive.
Well, and Jenny and Christy have recently educated us about the importance of eye protection when you're going.
Absolutely. Yes. Thank you, Robin. Mm-hmm. Yes, I had a close call, and so I bought myself some safety glasses, and what do you know? The first time I wore them, I got hit square in the eye.
Right in the face. Wow. So do these safety glasses, do they actually have like a lens in them, or just is it just the ring that protects the eye?
No, these have a lens.
Oh, they do? Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Huh. In case somebody's racket gets flying out of their hand.
No, it's the ball.
I know, but
I guess
then
that's
you don't
true.
Really need glass.
Yeah.
If it just had the rim there,
yeah,
it would hit and stop.
I have, like, tossed my paddle at a ball when, like, it was too much for me to get it. Like,
so
hey,
you
let me just throw my
tossed
paddle
your
at
paddle. Go get it. Fetch.
I know, because I wasn't moving fast enough.
You could have been like Samantha and just wiggled your nose and had to paddle go do it, you know?
People don't understand that reference
anymore. Well,
you know,
gotcha.
You got to be our age to understand what in the world that was all about. Yeah,
your Samantha, age, maybe, yeah.
You wiggled your nose.
Yeah,
you know, she was pretty cute when she did that, too, by the way.
She was. She was just a beautiful woman and acted beautifully in that setting.
Yes, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah, so no twinkling noses up there.
No. We do talk about making good business decisions with the ages that most of us are at. That, like, yeah, it's not worth it. Pastor Robin, when she plays, she doesn't have an off switch. Mm-mm. So she will throw herself on the floor, and that's not...
I will dive for
whole
things.
Whole body committed.
It's just not wise.
Yeah. I've threatened to kick people out of the group because, no, you don't dive for balls. You just let them
go. Yeah, but, you know, she dives with no fear because she's so low to the ground already.
Oh, Pastor
nice.
Mike.
Well done.
Oh,
she's
my
just,
goodness.
She's so,
from
you know, weebles wobble, but they don't fall down. They just kind of.
She does not wobble.
She is. No, that was my old life.
Well, that woman can ride a bike like nobody's business, though. Mm. So
it's fun.
Yeah.
Cycling is fun.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
until
so we really got off on a.
We totally did.
A whole wound up.
Yes, you
here.
Did.
Pickleball. Yes, I did. Yes. Well,
excuse
when
me.
You told me about the five love languages of pickleball, I'm like, okay, Jenny, you gotta stick around. I gotta get some information out of you as the show starts this morning.
Yeah, we have some friends coming to visit us in a couple of weeks, and I asked them, like, oh, are you playing back a pickleball? And they're actually coming out from Washington State. And Washington State is actually where pickleball originated back on Bainbridge Island.
No.
So, yes.
I took the ferry there.
Yeah.
I love that little
yeah,
island.
Yeah, it's a beautiful spot. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Wow.
And, yeah, so it originated there. So I harassed her. She said, that's for old people. I'm like, did you know the number one player in the world is, well, she was 16. Now she's 17.
Ooh.
So, yeah, she's a
you know, this is
lame.
The kind of show where you can learn stuff. Every Friday morning, you can show and you can learn stuff.
Uh-huh.
I never knew that.
Yeah, youngest
player. Now ask me in an hour if I remember it. There's another thing, too.
Yes.
God, where's my diaper?
I was going to say, we had diapers, we had memory. Awesome. We're on a roll.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's so funny. Yeah, so we have two pickleball courts here at church. Upstairs, we have a boxing ring up there. We have a workout area with weights. We have two
Karate,
pickleball courts.
Dojo.
You know, well, you know, that plays right into what I believe and have taught for years, my whole ministry, that... People always emphasize growing spiritually. You got to grow spiritually. No. To grow mature, you need to grow in four quadrants, four areas of your life. Luke 2:52. Jesus grew in wisdom, grew mentally. I know some people who are very spiritual, but they're as sharp as a box of rocks. Not fun to be around. Very immature.
Well, some rocks are smooth. You might want to come up with a different metaphor. Right? Did I screw that up in my head?
No, you did fine.
Okay.
I'm just trying to think, okay, one fry short of a Happy Meal.
There we go.
Elevator, don't go to the top
there
floor. I mean, you know, there's a few others. You know, whatever. But Jesus grew in wisdom. He grew in stature. He grew physically. And, you know, physically, you need to take care of it. The body's a temple. Now, I don't go this whole route of shaming Christians to hell because they smoke a cigarette or they have a beer. Where I grew up and am still around so many Christians that they're not even aware of it. They are that legalistic. And I don't know where it started or how it got there, but they can weigh 400 pounds, no problem. My issue is, I don't care if you weigh 400 pounds, or if you smoke a cigarette or have a beer. The idea is, you gotta realize and recognize the fact that your body is a temple. You should take care of it. Now, that doesn't mean you got to be Arnold Schwarzenegger or whoever the bodybuilder is today. I don't know. That you got to be, you know, this world-class anything. But you just got to be healthy. Take care of yourself. So, pickleball up there, and our whole upstairs, the boxing rim, the karate group, weight room, the pickleball courts, is all about that other quadrant, being healthy, mm-hmm. providing an opportunity to be healthy.
Which I think really melds itself. We've been talking about how the quadrants just really cross over one another.
Yeah, they do, because the next one is social.
Yep, exactly.
You know, Jesus grew in favor with God, spiritual, and man. He grew socially. And again, unfortunately, so many Christians are such nerdy weirdos.
Sticks in the mud.
Oh, dear Lord. You don't want to be around them or talk to them.
Well, I had never heard of that as a Christian until I came to Maranatha well over 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. And I was well into my faith at that point. It was like I had never heard anything but grow spiritually.
Yep.
So. Amen.
And I've been emphasizing this idea of we need to grow like Jesus grew. Mm-hmm. And we have the picture right there. Mm-hmm. It tells us how he grew. Mm-hmm. He grew in all four of those areas. So mm-hmm. I think all four of those areas are important. You are not a fully developed, mature Christian. Now, is one going to be farther than the other? Well, of course. Mm-hmm. But if you're not working on all four, then you're missing the boat.
Well, and there's an abbreviation in the whole of how you can minister when that happens.
True.
You know, I mean, I know wonderful, wonderful people whose ability to minister looks very different because they physically are unable, right?
Out of shape. Or mm-hmm. I know some others that are they're really literally inadequate or not as sharp or as smooth in their ministry because they can't talk to people about anything intelligent. Anything about what's going on in the world. They don't know how to dissect stuff. They don't know how to think, you know, critically. They just spit out Bible stuff that they've always learned their whole life. They just keep spitting out all this. It's like, are you kidding me?
Well, if we had a nickel for every time I heard you say, I would love to give that person a homiletics class, or I would love to give that person a hermeneutics class, you know, there'd be no debt. I mean,
I remember in Bible college, it was at a speech class. This was early on. This wasn't even a homiletics class. It was a speech class. And I gave a speech, you know, I'm a freshman in college, and I'm in speech class, and I'm giving this speech, and I'm rather emphatic, and I'm using a lot of energy and whatever else. And when I was done, the teacher said to the whole class, he said, if you want to keep that up, you need to stay in good shape. Mm-hmm. I mean, he said, if you're going to be preaching, you know, the way preaching should be done, which I'm not sure what that means exactly, but it should be energetic and passionate and mm-hmm. whatever. He says, you need to stay in shape. Mm-hmm. So I've tried.
Well, keeping the saw sharpened is
my smoking's down to a pack a day.
Well, there's just
okay, I'm joking.
You.
To all our listeners, they need to understand that was a sarcastic joke.
Well, that applies in all those areas. Keeping the saw sharpened means you got to use it.
So, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it's great encouragement.
So all four of those areas to grow. And this idea, I think, of pickleball, too. They might not see it as really developing, but the social aspect. You know, Proverbs 27:17 says, as iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. There is this idea that you become like the people you hang around. Now, the Bible doesn't say that lead sharpens lead or lead sharpens steel. And I know some Christians who are, they're hanging around people and they're hoping that these people are going to help them be better and sharper and all that. They're not. They're lead. Iron sharpens iron. This idea of koinonia, this coming together, rubbing up against one another. And that's really what this idea of iron sharpening iron is. This idea of rubbing up against one another in relationship. That's one of the benefits. I like coming to work because I like coming to harass all of you.
Mission accomplished.
I succeed at it, right?
Ditto.
Yeah, I do. I look forward to it. We come. Mm-hmm. We have a good time together. Mm-hmm. You never know what kind of discussion is going to come up.
Right.
What road we might go down. And mm-hmm. I think we have a lot of fun.
Yeah.
We do.
No, you're,
we really
yeah,
do.
See, now you're saying that because you have to, right? Yeah.
No, I get to because it's true.
Yeah.
It is true.
You know, the environment here is amazing and we get to work with each other and we get to frustrate each other. We get to cry together. We get to laugh together. We get to get better together and grow together.
I'm glad you don't invite me in on the cries together.
I'm pretty sure I cried
okay,
in your office
yeah,
before, not because of
I
what you said.
Yeah, I know.
Maybe what
challenge
I've done. I know.
And I didn't make you cry either.
No.
But I have to admit, I am not ashamed. I've been known to cry as well. There's something about when the Spirit of God is around and touching your heart. When you no longer can sense the touching and the moving of the Holy Spirit and are moved emotionally, then you're dead. Because God being real and active is the most exciting thing ever.
Well, amen.
And he doesn't hit us just in our intelligence. It's a full body being interaction with him, right?
We are emotional beings.
Yes, and the leadership here has worked hard to make this a very safe place. So it's a safe place to work in. So
you can be real, just be who you
are. Amen.
Yep.
Amen.
The freedom to fail is the empowerment to succeed. People ask me all the time, hey, can I try it? Yeah, go try it. Well, what if it doesn't make it? Well, then we'll know. Let's go try.
Right.
Let's go try stuff.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, hey, station manager, Jenny, thank you so much for letting me harass you.
Absolutely.
For this big opening and everything else that has ensued.
Anytime.
From there, go do your pickleball thing and try not to take somebody's eye out. Because you're wearing.
I will try not to.
Because you're wearing the glasses, but your opponents are not.
Well, I'm really trying not to aim at people's faces. I'm just trying to keep it in the court, but you never know where it'll go.
You know, I know
that
you have a wicked, vicious, competitive spirit once in a while, and you never know when that thing will just, like, jump out. Just kind of, whoa, there it is.
You think I? Well, you've been up there when the guys have been playing.
Oh, yeah,
they're
bad, too.
They
well, you got to remember, when you get, like, my age, in your mind, you are better than what you ever were.
In your mind,
you are better than you ever were. And so when you see this ball, you know, man, I get that thing. Your mind says it can, but your body says no.
What are those people called, Jenny, that hit it so hard?
Banger. Don't be a banger.
Don't be a banger.
A banger?
They hit the ball as hard as they can every time.
Right.
You will not be popular on the court if you were a banger.
I thought that was the idea. Crush the opponent. Destroy them.
You could probably find a group of people that would want to play that way.
Okay, so again, to our listeners, this is a show where you can learn things.
Nice.
You learn banger.
Don't be a banger.
Don't be a banger. Oh, my gosh.
Which is different than when I was in high school, because a banger was somebody who really enjoyed, like, heavy metal rock music.
True.
Like
headbanger.
Headbanger, yeah.
Yep.
God.
Dating myself.
I'm surrounded by old
right
people.
Right there with you.
Wow. We are all in good company, aren't we?
Okay. Thanks for having me on.
Oh, thanks. Have a great day.
You guys, too. Have fun.
We shall. Okay. Pastor Robin, so... Yeah, usually we start out with you telling us about some national holidays and things that are going on.
Oh, yeah, there are some exciting ones today. Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Okay. International Wild Koala Day is today. National Bike to School Day.
Bike to School Day.
Bike to School Day.
Does that mean motorcycle, too?
I got no more specification.
No more specification. Yes. See, when I refer to my motorcycle, I call it my bike. It's my bike.
Right. And I don't. I call my bicycle my bike.
Want to know a funny story?
All the time.
Years ago, one of the secretaries here at church named my motorcycle. Yep.
And it was?
Visitation.
Oh.
She called it Visitation. So when people called and said, is Pastor Mike there? She would say, no, he's out on visitation.
Nicely done. You just gave away a state secret. Okay. National Chocolate Custard Day. National Garden Meditation Day.
What?
Yep.
They have a national day for that.
Oh, yeah. Well, here's
I'm
the better
I'm surprised
one.
By most of these national days.
Oh, yeah. Here's National Lumpy Rug Day.
Lumpy rug?
Lumpy rug. If you've got a lumpy rug, today is
today
your day.
Today is your day, man. You celebrate with all the gusto.
Man. National Paranormal Day. Don't want to go near that. National Raspberry Popover Day. That's not so bad. I could embrace that day.
I could, too. I like raspberries.
Right. National Specially Abled Pets Day.
Specially Abled?
I wonder if this is I mean,
in other words, these are for people whose pets aren't retarded.
Or I don't know. I don't know if they have like special abilities, like super smell, or I don't know.
Say it again.
National Specially Abled Pet.
Nationally Specially Abled Day.
You kind of got that. Okay, so then National Textiles Day, fabric. National Two Different Color Shoes Day.
Mine are both the same color today.
Good. Here's one.
And they're called a pair.
Here's one your
a
wife would
shoes.
Love.
Hey, just really quick, How about your shoes?
What about my
Let
shoes?
Let me see.
I have my
boring.
Black,
not
black
even
boots
celebrating
on.
The national
no.
different colored shoe day.
Such a lahoozer.
Hey, how about our producers over there? You guys got the same shoes? They both look alike?
Well, they're checking it out. There they go.
Yeah,
oh,
there they go. They're showing us.
Look at
us.
How predictable.
Boring.
Okay, so this is a day that your wife would love.
Okay.
Wordsmith Day.
Yeah,
Pastor Arlene loves words.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. National No Pants Day.
What?
I didn't tell you.
What?
I didn't tell you
Where
about
are they
this
celebrating
day.
That?
Yeah, I didn't tell you about this day ahead of time
because wow.
I did not want to risk, you know.
Well, let's
finding
get in
out
the
more
spirit
about
of
you
things,
than we all wanted to know.
Oh my gosh. National, oh, not,
national
what does that mean?
No
you
pants day.
You got to wear a dress?
I
wear a swimsuit? You wear
who knows?
If you're Jenny, you put your Depends on?
I don't know. Or you wear
I could say that because she's not here
tights
anymore.
Or leggings that are flesh colored. I don't know. The whole thing is just probably not a good idea.
To even inquire too much about.
Embrace. I mean, you could certainly wear a skirt or maybe a guy a kilt or something like that. But I wouldn't take it too far.
I have a kilt.
Yep.
You've seen me in my kilt.
I have.
Yep.
Yeah.
I've worn a kilt.
Yep. And I don't see you wear a kilt like just on random days. Like, hi, I'm going to wear a kilt today. But, I mean, for special events, for the Blue Knights and whatnot, I see you wear your kilt.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I do want to let everybody know, though, tomorrow is a really big day. Are you ready? Tomorrow is May 4th, which is Star Wars Day. And you get to wish everybody, May the 4th be with you all day. They're shaking their heads like
yeah,
so
we're all
lame.
Shaking our heads. We're all shaking our heads. But Pastor Robin is a major Star Wars geek. Mm-hmm. You walk in her office and you see Star Wars characters. And
well, you got to be careful what people find out you like because...
Then you get more of it, yeah.
You get more of it.
Yeah. I have quite a few skulls in my office.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I got two more skulls 2 days ago.
Nice.
Yep.
Nice.
I get skulls
mm-hmm.
and
I'm calling
Oreos.
It curating a collection. That's, you know, I've been reframing that with my husband. It's like, how many of those do you need? Honey, you don't seem to understand. I'm curating a collection.
A collection.
There you go.
I am too. And all the things that I think they're cool and all that, as soon as I die, they're just going to dump them all in a box and throw them in the garbage.
Who knows? Mm-hmm.
That's probably what they'll do. You know,
mm-hmm.
just all it goes, oh, go to the garage sale. Hey, by the way,
mm-hmm.
we have a huge garage sale going on. Both today and tomorrow. Today, it's already started. It starts at 9 o'clock. Opens at 9 o'clock. This is a huge garage sale.
Mm-hmm.
Every year, our church does it. It is huge. It is worth the drive over, up, down, across, to whatever to get here. It starts at 9 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
And it goes until, what, 5? Something like that? I don't know.
I'll look it up quickly.
Yeah, I don't know the time. And then tomorrow it opens up at what time? God, we're doing great, aren't we?
We are doing great.
You can tell that we're not in charge of the garage sale.
Okay, so today it's from 9 to 5.
9 to 5. I was right, 5 o'clock.
Right, and what's special about today is if you come from 9 to 10, it's a dollar. Is that right? I don't have it here. Anyway, it's 9.
That was the big kid sale.
Okay, I was looking at donations. My apologies. So Friday today, it's from 9 to 5, and for tomorrow, 7 to 2.
7 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
Bright and early.
Bright and
Hit
early.
It. It's full of stuff. Mm-hmm. Man, that lobby out there, our lobby is 11,000 square feet, and it's packed. And then into the actually sanctuary area, again, tables upon tables upon tables upon tables upon tables
yeah.
of stuff.
Yes, somebody else's treasure.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, it's really amazing how you can walk through there and go, oh, wow, I didn't think I needed one of those, but I'm really impressed now that I do.
Well, I actually got in there a little bit early, and the team let me. I found a lampshade that I needed.
A lampshade.
Totally needed that.
Well, tell you what, we're going to go to break, and I'll see you put that lampshade on your head. See how that goes. You're listening to Something to Think About with me, Pastor Mike, a production of WAJC, Your Life Radio on 88.1 and 91.7 FM. We'd love to hear from you. If you have questions or comments about today's show, email us at waj@yourliferadio.com. If you're ever in the Forest Lake area, I'd love to personally invite you to join us for a Sunday morning service at 9:30 a.m. or Wednesday evenings at 6:30 p.m. There's something for everyone.
Something to Think About with Pastor Mike is a production of WAJC Your Life Radio, which is owned and operated by Maranatha Assembly of God in Forest Lake, Minnesota. You can find more information on the web at realchurch.org. Now, back to Something to Think About.
And here we go, garage sale. We just left with that information today, 9 until 5, and then tomorrow, 7 a.m. until 2 p.m. Hey, you know, it'd be nice to announce the fact that we have a bike blessing. Blessing of the bikes. Sunday, June 2nd. Last year, 1,000 motorcycles showed up in our parking lot and drove through the lobby to get blessed, get prayed for. It was just, it's just a lot of fun. It really is. It's gimmicky. Yep, absolutely. Kind of fun, though. Just fun. To mess around.
And you get to pray for folks.
We actually, yeah, you know, we talk about a blessing on the bikes. Yeah, we bless the bike. And we take from that idea that, like Paul, handkerchiefs were brought to him so he could pray for them, and they brought them back to other people, and they got healed. So there's this idea of a blessing. But we don't put a lot into that. We're really about praying for the rider, mm-hmm. the driver.
Sure.
Literally praying for them. And the number of people who, man, while they're praying, man, tears are coming down their face. They're just genuinely touched by the care, concern, and by the presence of God.
Right, because it isn't about quantities of numbers, like some rote prayer. It's a really sincere, heartfelt
yep.
discussion with the Lord. Quickly, but unique to that person, and it's moving.
And oftentimes, as they pull up to the person going to be praying for them, they'll tell them, could you pray for so-and-so? Could you pray for my mother? Could mm-hmm. you pray for my brother? Could you pray for my sister? Whatever. Mm-hmm. And they have a specific need, and then that person is able to then literally pray for them, like you said, personalize, mm-hmm. really personalize it. Mm-hmm. So that's May, or June 2nd, June mm-hmm. 2nd, and it's around 12 o'clock, but you need to get here early. And you can come to church that day if you want, enjoy the service, and then stick around for the blessing. Or you can just show up for the blessing of the bikes, you know, later. Just come straight to that as well. Hey, as our day is rolling on, let's maybe try to get to something a little bit more serious. So what's on your mind?
What's on my mind? There's a variety of things on my mind. Yeah.
You know, I think about, so I come every Friday to the show, just having left a Friday morning men's Bible study. Mm-hmm. And I've been leading this men's Bible study for 44 years, a little over 44 years.
That's a long time.
Mm-hmm. We used to meet in town. I mean, we've met all over. Last 10, 12, 15 years or so we've met. No, probably the last 20 years we've actually met here at church. People come in, they cook a nice breakfast. We enjoy a good time. Some of the discussion that happens at this Bible study is just so fun. Like today, we just finished the book of Hebrews, so we're going to start the book of James. And I was just reading some of the, and talking about what the book of James is, who was it written to, who wrote it, and all that. And, you know, talking about the fact that it was written by James, the brother of Jesus. Mm-hmm. You know, some people, because of their church tradition, they don't talk about it, but because they don't want to say that Jesus had other brothers and sisters, but the Bible says that he had brothers and sisters,
right.
And their brothers' names are listed.
Right.
But I told the guys, I said, listen, to our Catholic brethren out there who don't believe that, don't make a big issue out of it.
Right.
It's not that big a deal.
Mm-hmm.
It's just not worth making, you know, trouble over.
Right. Well, they'll find out when they get there.
Exactly. Surprise! Then, surprise, yeah, we'll get to meet on stuff. It doesn't change much theology and all mm-hmm. that. It's just not worth it. Mm-hmm. So we went from that and talked about, you know, this is Brother James. And then we talked a little bit about how James is like one of my favorite books.
Me too, I confess.
To me, it's, mm-hmm. if I was going to rename it, I would call it Rubber Meets the Road.
Oh, yeah.
Put it into practice.
That's
just
right.
Do it. Because James basically says that, don't tell me you're a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Show me by your life.
Right.
I think James would have said, I can tell if you're a Christian because you put your cart away.
Oh, you mean at the store?
Yeah. Mm. When you go to Target and you go to Walmart and mm-hmm. other places like this, that you put your cart away.
Mm-hmm.
That's what James is basically saying. Don't call yourself a Christian and don't do some of the elementary, basic kindness things that a Christian would do.
Mm-hmm.
And then the second maybe favorite book for me would be the book of Galatians.
Oh, yeah.
Which ironically is the exact opposite.
Hmm.
So for me, if you want to be really well balanced, you take the freedom that Paul talks about in Galatians.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he is talking about such freedom there that it just, it's mind-boggling. And most Christians, because we have a lot of Phariseeism in us,
mm-hmm.
they cringe. They just, no, you can't talk about that freedom. I don't know what to do with this. Yeah, you got to add this to it. You got to do this to it. It's like, nope, you're saved by grace through faith.
End of story.
Period.
Yep.
You know? And then you take James, and then I talked about how when the Reformation took place, one of the keys was over this idea, and I asked the guys, I said, so tell me the story about Martin Luther. And nobody could, unfortunately. I said, because our background shapes how we see things today.
Whether we realize it or not.
And that was what I emphasized. Mm-hmm. We all have a preconceived idea. Mm-hmm. We all look through a lens of a certain color. And that's how we see everything. So I view everything as a person who was raised as a Catholic, got saved, got called into the ministry. I'm a Protestant, evangelical, Pentecostal. And everything I look at, I just got to be aware of the fact that's my perspective.
Right.
That's my mindset. Mm-hmm. So I look through everything that way.
Right.
Nobody can look at the scripture and go, well, I'm just going to just let the scripture just really speak to me and just say, believe what it said. No, we all bring into it certain ideas.
We do.
So Martin Luther, I asked him, I said, so why do you think that Martin Luther wanted to get rid of the book of James? Because he did. He didn't think the book of James belonged in the Bible.
Really?
Yep.
Wow.
He was objected to it. He did not like it. He really thought it should be taken out of the canonization of Scripture. And I asked the group, do you know why? And it was like, silence.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, no. I said, you got to think about it. Martin Luther was a priest,
mm-hmm.
you know, in the church. And you can never be holy enough. So back in the day, they used to, you know, whip themselves, sit on poles, you know, out and they would just be ascetic. That was the word they used, asceticism, to do without, to punish the body, to get rid of all the joy of the flesh, because from the flesh comes all sorts of evils and all that. And they could never feel holy enough. So they were actually some of his superiors were actually concerned for him because he was just really kind of losing it, whipping himself all the time and flagellating himself and doing all this thing. And they said, you know, we got to get him out of there. So they put him copying scripture.
Oh, sure. A scribe.
A scribe.
Yeah.
So he was copying scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where God met him as he was in the scriptures, just going through it, which is a good note for all of us. A lot can happen if we just go into the scriptures.
Well,
it should be a part of our daily living.
It is interesting to hear that he was writing the scriptures out because, I mean, not legalistically, but that was one of the requirements for kings in the Old Testament, that they write the scriptures out.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
I did not know that. That's
mm-hmm.
interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so he comes across Galatians. You are saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like this huge epiphany that you are saved by grace. There's nothing you could do. So having come from his extreme, you know, torturing himself, purging himself, he comes to that thing, and no doubt when he comes to the book of James, he goes, no, I don't want nothing to do with that. That's wrong. That's where I was.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a good lesson for all of us, that the pendulum, being careful how far it can swing.
Right. And it's really encouraging, actually, to hear that the Word of God provoked him, because that's what it does.
Yeah, the Word
it's
of God
doing
provokes.
Its job.
It challenges us.
It challenges us.
Mm-hmm. When you read the Scriptures, if you don't naturally come up with questions,
mm-hmm.
Then you need to be challenged to, you should be filled with questions.
Mm-hmm.
The more you want to get to know about God or the scriptures, you need to learn how to ask good questions.
Well, and I think there are a number of folks out there who are intimidated with the idea of, you know, there's 66 books in there. How am I ever going to know? It's just so large. And, you know, it's not like there's a table of contents that takes you maybe topic by topic or whatever. But we've come so far in support to help people with Bible study and understanding how we are supposed to appropriately approach scripture and what it was relating to back in the ancient times when it was written and what principles we look for today. You know, so there's assistance out there. You don't have to be intimidated by the Word of God. You can learn.
Absolutely. James, I just love it. He primarily was about the practical and the ethical. He was emphasizing duty rather than doctrine. Mm. If you want doctrine, you read the book of Romans. Mm-hmm. Because Paul is writing out a case for the Christian faith to a group of people he's never seen, he's never been there.
Right.
So he's writing this thing. So if you want to get a good understanding of Christian doctrine, mm-hmm. you read the book of Romans.
Right.
Just good stuff. Mm-hmm. But James, man, I love it. You know, he says, you say you have faith. Mm-hmm. I'll show you my faith by my actions.
Right. Which is beautiful because the faith that you have leaves evidence. And James is saying that. What's going on between you and the Lord? The evidence of that is in your life. It just squirts out.
So I have put that, and you've heard me say this 100 times. Mm-hmm. I am not interested in hearing people tell me what they believe. Mm-hmm. I'll watch your life, and I'll tell you what you believe.
Right.
And that's basically what James is saying. Mm-hmm. You know, you can say all kinds of things. I believe this. I believe that. Tell you what, I'll watch your life, and I'll tell you what you really believe.
Right.
Because we do what we believe.
Right. And learning to live in that tension of, you know, this is the direction that a healthy faith life is moving in with the grace that you talk about in Galatians and the freedom and all of that. You know, we're always walking that fine line with the direction of the Holy Spirit. What should I do here? What brings you glory? What are my healthy boundaries, Lord, as I navigate through this life, sharing your love with other people?
It is a tension. Mm-hmm. Not like a tightrope that we need to be that, you know, oh,
right.
my God, comfortable. But there's got to be this tension. And I think the tension on both sides is what keeps us going down the middle of the path.
Right.
Being somewhat very balanced, because we can err easily on being pharisaical. Rules, rules, rules. Don't do this. Don't do this. Don't do this. Do this. Do this. Do this. Mm-hmm. To... Hey, it doesn't really matter. I don't even have to go to church to be a Christian.
Right. Sloppy grace.
Just, gosh, I can just do whatever I want. Well, technically, yeah, you don't have to go to church to become a Christian, but I can guarantee you, you are not going to grow. You're not going to be a disciple if you're not a part of a body of believers.
There are some things you learn only in relationship. You know, there's an abbreviation in your system if you're choosing to stay away from community.
Mm-hmm. Have to do it. You know, obviously in all my years, I've seen a lot of people come and go. They church hop. They have given all kinds of reasons. Well, I'm not being fed here. Or I don't like this. I don't like that. They come across, you know, some YouTube teaching about not tithing or some YouTube teaching about, you know, Jesus' real name is Yeshua. And God is not answering people's prayers today because it says if you call on my name and we're not using his name properly, that God is not answering our prayers because he's not hearing us because we're not using his name Yeshua. And you get going down some of these little bunny trail weird. Can I just say it now? If I offend anybody out there, I'm really sorry, but it's weird. Don't make my God and your God so small that he stands in heaven with his hands folded and said, nope, I can't hear you. Mm-hmm. Not until you say my name. I'm not going to hear you. Don't make our God that frivolous.
That's crazy town. I mean, I think about like my kids. It was years before my kids knew my name. It didn't make any difference in my relationship with them.
Yeah.
You know, who cares what my name is?
Yeah, they didn't
even
have to say mom. They just had to, Wah!
You know, I'm
and
like,
you're going to come running and get their attention. I think God is the same way with us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he hears us.
Right.
He does not insist that we pronounce his name properly. And you just seriously, every once in a while, and this is what I mean by growing mentally, growing intelligently, growing the four quadrants of our life. That's what I mean. These Christians, who they're not thinking.
Right.
Because what you're saying is a mute person can never talk to God.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you want to take what they're saying and extrapolate it out to the end.
What? Critical thinking?
Oh, that's me. What a concept. God, what a concept.
Sorry.
Oh, my gosh.
Not a bash the church thing, but it's like we do not check our brains at the door. We need to understand this. And if you're not in a group of people where you share your ideas intentionally, you'll never benefit from the beauty of the body of Christ going, something's not quite right about that. Or that's a great direction to go in. move further that way. And that's part of how we help one another.
Absolutely. It was said to me, actually, it was a secretary of church years ago. She said, Jesus came to take away our sins, not our brains.
That is too true. Mm-hmm.
It's really true. I think so many times, and I think that's where a lot of atheists have problems with us as Christians, because to them it appears that once we come to faith, we just throw our brains out the window and we just say, well, we don't care what science says or what, you know, this and this really does. I just believe. And we just kind of go on from there. Well, yeah, some of the things that we believe are like really stupid.
Mm-hmm. And it's fascinating, just in my lifetime, as a believer, watching scientific discovery that supports that there's God. It's like almost like science is catching up with the spirit.
I personally believe that's really true. Mm-hmm. I mean, some of the most intelligent minds out there are really coming to faith all the time. Mm-hmm. And they're proving that there is intelligent design.
Right.
There is intelligent design. It didn't just happen.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Again, we come full circle back to this whole idea. If you're going to grow, you're going to be mature, it has to be in all four areas.
Right.
Yeah. And some of the, again, you know, I'm a Pentecostal, as I said.
What does that mean, Pastor Mike?
A Pentecostal. I believe that the baptism of the Holy Spirit, what happened in Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 4, 5, 9, and on, that it is here for today. The Apostle Paul, years after Acts chapter 2, he writes to the Corinthians. He says, listen, I speak in tongues more than you all. I wish you all spoke in tongues. So that's just one of the ministry gifts of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And I believe the baptism of the Holy Spirit is for today. All the workings of the gifts are for today. And I just believe it's so true. Now, there are denominations out there. In fact, one guy in particular who just came out and he said that if you're a Pentecostal, he believes that you are Pentecostal by the power of the devil.
Right.
That you're demon-possessed.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, okay, so Pentecostalism, great theologians, it's the largest growing denominational around the world.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, and he's blaming that on the devil.
Right, unfortunately. And that's one of the reasons, that's a great caution, Pastor Mike. We really need to understand the well from which we drink.
Yes.
And that's an argument, in my opinion, for knowing your teachers. Not that you're going to know everything about them, but if you don't know what they believe, if you don't know how what they believe comes out in their life, you're really looking at a stool without a leg. You just simply don't know that that person is solid.
Yes.
And you want to be careful about who you listen to and what their paradigms are, because there are teachers out there that, frankly, in my opinion, are dangerous to the body of Christ. You do not, they end up, their crazy ideas end up damaging people.
A whole bunch of damage, harm.
And, you know, we're in situations where for years we get the privilege of helping people hopefully walk past that and forgiveness and wholeness and all of that. But, man, it's just you need to know who you're learning from.
And, you know, none of us are 100% accurate probably in the
right
explanation of our doctrine. But we're not, you know, wackadoodle. Like, that is wackadoodle.
Mm-hmm.
Seriously, that is dangerous wackadoodle. So, so scary dangerous.
Right.
But just as crazy as some of those other things I mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
I mentioned a few weeks ago that there was a group of people who, a few years ago around this area, were preaching that Jesus can't come back until Christians stop dying. Now, people think, you're just making this up. No, I mean, this was for real.
Wow.
They believe the rapture wasn't really a rapture like the church teaches and preaches, that we're going to be raptured out of this earth and every eye shall see him and be caught up together with him in the clouds. No, they thought the rapture was that when you believe so strongly that your blood turns into spirit, then you'll live forever. I'm like, are you kidding? And that's like, again, just these crazy things like, you know, God doesn't answer prayer because we're not using his name properly. It's just, yeah, there's so many of these ridiculous kind of things.
Right.
That is important, like you said. Kind of know the background.
Mm-hmm.
Know who you're preaching. And there's where have an understanding of the doctrines of the denomination that you go to. Mm-hmm. What denomination is the church you go to?
Right.
There's definite differences, but that doesn't make any of them wackadoodle.
Right. And I know for me, with different research that I'm doing, you know, back in the day, I got the privilege of being our discipleship pastor. We have Pastor Michelle Ingram, who is our discipleship pastor today. But back in the day, when people would come with curriculum, I would need to do due diligence and go online and find out if this person was plugged into a church and what did their church believe. And you can tell a lot. There are in the about, you know, them, and it's great to actually look at the staff and see the variety of who's on staff. It's interesting to see when all of those who have the title pastor are only male, and if you're a female on staff, you're a director. Okay, I know where you're coming from. And, you know, just what they believe about the baptism of the Holy Spirit and where that all fits today. And not that they're bad people at all.
Yeah.
But you do need to be careful about their teaching. And I know around here, we really want to be careful and celebrate the things that we can celebrate and steer clear of the holes that people really don't need to fall into, because lives are damaged. You know, it hurts people.
It does.
And we don't want to do that.
And obviously, sometimes we need to go deep in theology and have a firm understanding. But
right.
where we drive down the street in mm-hmm. our faith
right.
really is keeping the main thing the main thing.
Completely.
I mean, that to me, my whole life, it's mm-hmm. like, you know, literally my whole life has been about breaking stereotypes, because mm-hmm. I believe everybody has them, mm-hmm. and most of these Christian stereotypes are wrong.
Right.
You know, you can't smoke, can't drink. I think about all the damage that the church has done. And again, people need to understand, these little white cigarettes, I never did smoke cigarettes.
I just
don't get it. But mm-hmm. I don't understand how the church has, you can't teach Sunday school because you smoke. You can't be on the board because you smoke. What in the world? The damage that we have done over this stupid thing, mm-hmm. and we feel so justified by it. It mm-hmm. just irritates the heck of me that I lost my train of thought.
Oh, sure.
I just get so cranked up mm-hmm. over that whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
So help me come back to where I was. I really did derail here.
That's funny.
I really did.
Well, and I think about teaching and what people believe and keeping the main thing the main thing.
Oh, that's it. Keeping the main thing the main thing. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
For my whole life, it's breaking stereotypes.
Mm-hmm.
And then keeping the main thing is two things. You know, Jesus, God gave the Ten Commandments to the Israelites.
Mm-hmm.
Gave it to the world, and mm-hmm. we value the Ten Commandments.
Right.
But Jesus stepped on the scene, and he basically took a big machete and got rid of eight of them. Hmm. In my mind, I visually see a tree with all these branches, and Jesus comes along with a machete, and he's whacking off. He's radical.
Hmm.
He's not an extremist. That means out there.
Okay.
He means radical, means go to the root. He was radical. He got rid of all these branches, and he had two standing there. Love God
mm-hmm.
with all your heart, all your soul, and all your strength. And love your neighbor like you love yourself. If we as Christians could concentrate on those two things, really focus our life on that. Love God, mm-hmm. love people.
Right.
Love God, love people.
Right. Well, and lest somebody is out there thinking we grunt and strain that out, that's part of the fruit of a healthy relationship with Jesus. You know, we have the infilling of the Holy Spirit, and he enables us with the fruit of the Spirit, kindness and patience and long-suffering. And so we have company and support while we're doing that.
And it's a joy.
Mm-hmm.
So many people, like you said, they grunt it out.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I got to do this, mm-hmm. and I got to do that. And I'm a Christian. I have to
have
do this.
To. Mm-hmm.
It's like, no, you need to be freed up and, you know, realize you get to.
Right.
This relationship with God is what a pleasure, what a joy, what a delight. It's like playing in the ocean,
mm-hmm.
in the ocean of his love.
Yeah, for sure.
Just playing and splashing around, enjoying the presence of God.
Mm-hmm. Which kind of circles back, in a sense, to this idea of four-quadrant living. You know, Jesus living, Luke 2:52,
mm-hmm.
because all of it matters. It all impacts faith and love and community and ourselves and others. And
it really does.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as we get ready to close up the morning show here today, for those of you who are listening, I hope and pray that you will just be encouraged. You know, maybe you've grown up in a church that you feel stifled by this and that, and some of the things that we've talked about today really have challenged you. You go, wow, I didn't realize I think that way, but I've always been under stress. I'm never measuring up. I'm never good enough. I keep trying, but I can't get there. Man, let the message of Martin Luther come through. You are saved by God's grace through faith alone. And when you relax and enjoy that, I believe you'll start doing the things that James talks about. So it's the horse before the cart, right, instead of the cart before the horse. Hey, you all be blessed. I hope you have a great weekend. See you next Friday.
Hey, thanks for tuning in today. Please join us right here each Friday morning at 8 a.m. If you have any questions or comments about today's show, email wajc@yourliferadio.com. You can hear more from Pastor Mike at Maranatha's website, realchurch.org, on the Messages and Media tab. The opinions expressed here are not necessarily those of the owner.
You may be an ambassador to England or France. You may like to gamble. You might like to dance. You may be the heavyweight champion of the world. You may be a socialite with a long string of pearls, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, indeed, you're gonna have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.